Today on Rambling About Cars, debuts. More new vehicles debuted in the last week than we've had in the last several months. And we're not going to talk about all of them, but we are going to talk about some of them that that stand out, some of them that are important, some of them that we just flat out want to talk about. That being said, ladies and gentlemen, friends, delightful drivers of the world, it is podcast time. I'm Christopher Smith. Across the way is co-host Chris Bruce. How you doing, Bruce?
I'm doing pretty good. I was about to say, you almost forgot to say it's podcast time, but you got there.
I can never forget that.
So tonight we have Kyle Connor with us, and he will be our guest. He sometimes works for our friends at IEVs, our partners. He's also from Out of Spec Studios. Kyle, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah. Hey guys. Yep. Just as you mentioned, a lot of time spent with Inside EVs. We have a weekly show over there that we do podcast every Friday morning. And yeah, thanks for having me on. Should be a blast. Super into cars my whole life. Love electric cars, combustion cars, things with two wheels. I actually just recently reviewed one of those mining earth movers, which is going to be interesting. It is, I think, one of the largest vehicles in the world, actually, which is amazing. So having a blast.
Can we skip some of these debuts and just talk about that?
Which brand of earth mover?
10-year-old yes. wants to just get a big model of that and play with it.
Yeah, it was called the Hitachi EH4000.
Okay.
Yeah, which is great. It looks like a giant Tonka toy. I was actually just editing that video while it came on here. I was over at Goodyear's Proving Grounds where we were driving Tesla Model S, a BMW 430i, Camaro ZL1. And then I was like, what's that?
You ran all of them over with the
I looked at it and I was like, what is that giant machine? And it has like 12-foot tall tires that cost $100,000 a piece. And I was like, can I drive it? And they're like, yeah, like no way. So I just,
there's a ZL1 and a Beamer there. Can I drive that?
Right. Yeah. And so that was the highlight of my automotive career. I think I'll never be able to reach that status again. And so that video will be on our Out of Spec Reviews channel, probably this weekend or early next week. So keep an eye out for it. The Hitachi EH4000 Earth Mover.
That sounds fantastic.
That needs to be the name of some super SUV from somebody.
Yeah.
The EH4000.
It's ready to
eat your neighbors for dinner.
I'm pulling up a picture of it now. Hold on. Here we go. This is it next to two Teslas. Sorry for the delay.
No. So for all of our audio listeners,
go to YouTube because you need to see that.
The Tesla basically comes up to the sidewall on the tires, and then there's a whole lot more tires. So,
like the bottom,
not the lower sidewall, right at the bottom.
Yeah, those things are cool. We should mention that. I mean, the reason we asked Kyle to join us, there were all kinds of vehicle debuts, and a lot of them were electric. I mean, folks, we're in the age of electric vehicles. This is sort of, it's an exciting time. We're not necessarily even at the beginning anymore. We're at the moment where here we are. It's not just occasional or a little niche thing. It's going mainstream, and we have some really good offerings to talk about. Do we want to start there? Where do we want to start? There's so many vehicles to choose from.
Well, if we want to start with an EV, we can do that. We can start talking about probably the biggest EV debut, in my opinion, in a while, and that's the Mercedes-Benz EQS.
Yes, the flagship.
Yeah,
sedan that took the internet, at least automotive kind of internet, by storm, because it does bear kind of a resemblance to the old Chrysler Cab Forward cars. We saw a few of those photoshops.
I will try to pull up that rendering, which I love.
Check out the new Chrysler 300.
For the time being, I will post
the old 300M, you know?
I will show an actual image of the car, and while we're talking about it, I will try to find that rendering because it is
really good. Kyle, I know you... You covered a lot on that. You read that entire 60-page Mercedes-Benz press release?
Yeah, did that. Spoke to like six different engineers on it. Played around with it in person. I was one of the lucky handful that got to spend some time in person with this car as well. And happy to talk about anything here. But I think the highlights are this is Mercedes-Benz big approach at basically going after the luxury EV segment. You know, certainly overshooting Model S in terms of quality, in terms of luxury. We are unsure about driving dynamics, but we can assume it's going to be, you know, as an S-Class should. And, you know, it's really going to be up there with closer to maybe the Lucid Air or Faraday Future FF90, I think, if that ever becomes a thing. So certainly playing in a luxury level higher than Model S.
I mean, I think it looks fantastic. I know the press release kind of talked even about that cab forward approach, because obviously there's no engine up front. Everything is pushed forward. And this car, I mean, it's an S-Class. Or it's the electric S-Class, so you know it's going to have a lot of space inside. But, I mean, it really has a lot of space inside.
So, real quick, before we talk about the inside, I want to roll back on something you just said, Smith. The fact that there's nothing under the hood, and then Mercedes has made it so that you never even have to open the hood, because the windshield wiper fluid refill is the flap on the side of the car.
Quirk alert. I wrote a little article about that, and it's
bizarre design decision.
I don't know how I feel about that. I mean, because it sort of breaks up the line on the outside of the car, but I mean, it's done in an attractive way. And I guess I think I theorized in my article where, well, you know, the quickest way to ruin your weekend vacation is if you are spilling your washer fluid when you've got it back in the trunk with all your goods. And of course, anybody that's ever filled washer fluid knows you're going to spill a little bit of it. So, hey, need to put it outside. It kind of breaks up the lines. But why isn't it under the hood? Because, yeah, there is no hood to open, which I found rather fascinating as well. There's no frunk area to store anything.
Yeah, increasingly EVs are getting less and less frunks, especially as we're seeing sort of these automakers that are, you know, from traditional combustion engine makers now switching to electric. First off, as an owner of, I think, 3 different EVs with front trunks, personally, I never use them. I can count on one hand how many times I've ever used a front trunk. I don't think they're necessary. And honestly, they're pretty clunky to open and close. Sometimes, like, for example, I drive a Model 3 and, like, you got to put your hand in a certain spot or it'll knuckle the aluminum, and then it's like a pain in the butt. So what Mercedes did here was they went for this clamshell giant hood design, all in the effort to get the lowest coefficient of drag of any series production vehicle in history. And a lot of this meant tucking the edges around, which means the hood can be opened, but only by a service center, of course. Mm-hmm. the washer fluid on the side there, I saw this in person. I actually don't think it's that elegantly done. I think this is a poor design decision. I think it breaks up, makes the car unsymmetrical side to side. And they put it on the driver's side, which is like every time you walk up to your car, you got to see this thing. And all you're thinking is washer fluid every time you get into your S-Class or EQS. And so I think it's a really dumb choice to put it there. They're, you know, it's Mercedes-Benz. They could have thought of so many more elegant solutions. Have a tube running from the side view mirror into the tank. Like, that's so clever. Many different options. And this is not the best work they've done, I think.
Yeah, so, you know, I would really love to hear from somebody at Mercedes the methodology behind placing that in the fender. It almost strikes me as we're making this electric car and it's designed to be electric from the get-go. It's not mm-hmm. an internal combustion car that we've converted, but yet we can't get rid of the side fuel door, you know?
So real quick, I want to hit one thing, and that is just kind of some very basic tech specs that we know. So at launch, we're going to be getting 2 versions of the EQS. There's the 450 with 329 horsepower, 406 pound-feet, and that's rear-wheel drive only. And then there's the EQS 580 4MATIC, which is Mercedes all-wheel drive term, and that's 516 horsepower and 611 pound-feet. And they're quoting a 4.1-second sprint to 60 for the quicker one, for the more powerful one, I should say. So that's for a big sedan, for a big luxury sedan, 4.1 seconds seems fine.
More than fine, but at the same time, I think people they've gotten so used to hearing Tesla doing 0 to 60 in like 2 seconds, and they don't. I mean, you say 4.1 seconds. Well, guys, that's fast. 4.1 seconds is fast, and in something that big, I think that goes over a lot of people's heads.
the buyer doesn't care for this car how fast it is, 0 to 60. You're not going to see these things launching off red lights. Personally, I think if you really only care about speed, you're going to go for the Model S because that's the one trick pony. Does it extremely well, launches quite hard. You know, in terms of range, you're going to have same battery pack, 107.8 kilowatt hour usable on both the 450 plus and the 580. However, the 580, like Bruce mentioned, is going to be that all wheel drive system. The rear motor, I believe, is the same across both, which is interesting. Just the level of detail that Mercedes went into this drivetrain system. They actually have a double winding in the rear motor. So it's six phases instead of a three phase. You have two different three phases on the rear axle. It means that the motor is going to be really smooth, going to produce big power across a wide speed range, and it means repeatability of performance. So while this isn't going to be the fastest car 0 to 60, Mercedes claims it's not going to just fall on its face and overheat after a lot of quick driving, let's just say.
And real quick, before we get into the interior, the other interesting thing to me, at least, is the range claim. And they're saying that this could get as much as 478 miles of range, according to the WLTP standard. And that's Tesla beating, if I'm not mistaken. Or Kyle, can you help me out there?
Yeah, WLTP is just a bunch of BS, in my opinion. It's not achievable. It's a totally, overinflated range estimates across almost every vehicle. The EPA is probably going to be in that high 300s, very low 400s. Not bad. You don't need any more, in my opinion. But range doesn't matter on an EV, in my opinion. It's all about the charging speed and how quickly you can charge it and then get back on the road. From 99% of people's driving, it's going to be from home to work. Pretty much any EV can do this. I daily drive an electric smart car with 50 miles of range, and I'm totally fine going to Starbucks in the morning and going around. The big thing for an EV, again, not range, in my opinion. I actually think we'll see a shift towards smaller battery packs well into the future when there's a larger influx of charging hardware. That's a whole nother problem we should talk about at some point. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's all about the charging speeds and for how long it can sustain that peak speed for. So Mercedes engineers claim 200 kilowatt peak DC fast charging, but it can sustain that pretty deep into the pack, which is a big deal for road tripping. A lot of EVs like Mustang Mach-E, for example, claim a big number, but can only hold it for a short period of time. So this will be interesting to play around with.
So let's talk about what I think is the absolute most impressive thing about the EQS. Yeah, the tech specs are cool, but look at that interior. Folks, if you're watching the YouTube video, you'll be able to see it now. Mercedes calls it the hyper screen. It's not actually one screen, even though there's a single bezel for it that all kind of incorporates it into one thing. It's three separate screens, but they look fantastic.
It looks like the future. I mean, that's really the best way to describe it.
Yes.
It looks like the future. You have, like you said, it's not one screen. There are three separate screens in there.
But it's all one bezel, so it kind of fudges it.
Yeah, I mean, it's all behind just kind of one big expanse. And, I mean, I think it looks fantastic. I wonder if it would lead to just kind of screen exhaustion after a while. If you tend to be a little sensitive to some of those things, I mean, it's all digital. Mm-hmm. It is digital from side to side. I mean, lots of great functionality, but I mean, let's also talk about, I mean, the rest of the interior, the center console design. I think it's a very elegant design. The rest of the interior here really, I think, complements what they did with that big, massive digital dash. And you would expect that sort of thing from Mercedes, though, right?
Yeah, you would. And the thing is, so Kyle, I listened to the last episode of the IEVs podcast, and I recommend our listeners to
absolutely
check that out too. And you guys were talking about the EQS, and I believe it was you, it might have been Martin, who brought up the kind of the differences between what we're seeing here and what we see in a Tesla Model S. The Tesla goes for minimalism. This is basically maximalism. This is, we are going to throw every bit of light and screen and whatever we can at you because you are a Mercedes-Benz buyer. You're spending six figures on this car. And so you deserve the best. Am I putting words in your mouth there?
I could have said that. You're absolutely right either way. If you were putting the words in my mouth, then I was correct. And look, first off, I got to spend a couple hours in the interior of the EQS. It's a great place to spend time. Beautiful seats. The ones you're seeing here are the comfort seats. Two different seating options, comfort and sport. I'd go for the comfort seats. You get nice pillows on the headrest too. Personally, I don't like the hyperscreen, so I totally disagree with you guys there. I think in person it looked a little weird, pretty reflection-y. Fingerprints for sure. Now, they claim that it's at the right angle. They've tinted the top of the windshield. They've baked in a special silicate to not show fingerprints, but in actuality, it's not one giant screen. You have two 10.2 inch displays, driver and passenger, and then a 17.7 in the middle. There are OLED screens on the right to the driver instrument clusters, LCD. Tons of great technology here in terms of forging the glass at 650 degrees C. It's a really impressive piece of engineering. They had to like build in crash safety into the screen itself. So there's like hexagonal mounts that are designed to break away behind the air vents if you have a severe side impact. Like, it's crazy the amount of effort that went into this. But here's the thing. If no one's sitting in the passenger seat, the passenger display is not usable. So therefore, you're left with the center display. And your driver instrument cluster and your center display, which would be no different if you didn't get the hyperscreen, and then you get a really nice wood dash behind there. And so it's not like you gain any functionality with the screen. There's no extra features or options that can come. MBUX works the same as it would on the 12.8 center display. It's hard to say if it's going to be worth the money, because all US spec EQS 580s comes standard with this screen. The 450 plus will be quite an expensive option. They wouldn't tell me the price. So if you're getting all-wheel drive, you're getting the hyper screen, you don't have to worry about it. But if you want the range spec, the one that goes the farthest, which is the 450 plus, the rear-wheel drive, I personally wouldn't spec it. I don't think it's worth any bit of money, to me at least, and I prefer having a wood dash and a Mercedes.
You know, you make a very interesting point. We're seeing this dash from the perspective of how Mercedes wants us to see it. Sure. Exactly, with their press photos. Seeing it in person, yeah. I mean, with the thought of, okay, you know, how smudgy are these screens going to get? What's that ambiance really going to be like? You raise some good points. It's always good to remember. Hey, automakers, they want to put on their best suit, if you will, when they're advertising these cars. So I'm very interested to see this in person.
Definitely. Absolutely. Because it looks really cool.
I think it looks like the future. But I mean, Mercedes is always, I mean, especially with their flagships, they've always had that reputation of, okay, here's what other automakers will be doing probably 5-10 years from now. We're doing it right now. So it'll be interesting to see how it goes.
Yeah, so my takeaway on this car is it's really a great electric vehicle tech, more so than we've ever seen from Daimler, way better than EQC, for example, which doesn't come to our shores. So blew me away in terms of electrical tech. I wouldn't say they're at Lucid or Tesla levels, but way more than I was expecting. Plus, everything great that we've learned and loved about the new S-Class, for example, 10 degrees of rear steering, great, you know, of course, comfort-oriented driving dynamics, all of these things coming together, I think, to make one of the most impressive and intoxicating electric vehicle packages for a luxury buyer. Mercedes can just do things that no startup can ever dream of.
Sure. For sure.
Yeah. So moving on from a car that's certainly going to cost six figures, undoubtedly, to one that you're actually going to, we're thinking 30s, maybe even low 30s to start. And the very first pickup truck for this brand in the United States. How about we talk about the Hyundai Santa Cruz?
Yes, let's talk about the Hyundai Santa Cruz. I think our listeners know that I'm not really a truck guy. But now, twice since we've started this revamped podcast in January, I've said I would kind of dig that. One was the Ford Bronco, which, okay, that's not really a truck, but
it kind of
has that off-road ambiance. And Hyundai, the Santa Cruz. I'm going to make a fairly bold statement here. Right now, I think Hyundai is the automaker leading the world when it comes to design choices. Everything that they're coming out with right now, pretty much everything, is just hitting me right in the feels. And I've never been a fan of big grills. But Hyundai's big grill, especially this new kind of blended design.
Yeah, that they started with the Tucson. It looks good.
I think it looks good. And of course, we have that here on the Santa Cruz. Mm-hmm. It's a compact truck. I've never been one that's needed a large truck. That said, I did once own an F-250 super cab long box diesel that for reasons I can't explain, if I could get it back, I would. I don't make sense, right? That's why I write about cars. It's got the 2.5 liter engine. It's standard with all wheel drive. Mm-hmm. In the base format, the engine is naturally aspirated, and I believe it's making 190 horsepower.
So that was a weird thing. Hyundai said 190 plus and plus. 180 plus for torque. They wouldn't come out with specific numbers for either the base motor or the optional engine. So we know it's at least going to be 190.
It'll be around there. I mean, the automakers do that.
It's certainly not going to be less than that.
You know, they do that when maybe they're still going through some emission certifications stuff. You know, we'll see how much we can get away with before, you know, we have to cut it up. So yeah, 190, 180 torque with the turbo. It's I better check my notes on that. 275.
275
and 310. So I mean, in something that small, the turbo, I mean, it's not gonna have any trouble getting out of its own way, even with the base engine. It won't be bad because it's a smaller vehicle. You know, the downside is, and I find this kind of ironic as well, because Hyundai doesn't want anybody to call this a pickup truck. They want this.
This is
what, a sport adventure vehicle.
That's correct.
It's not a truck. Obviously it's a unibody vehicle. You know, with the full on straight side, the bed isn't separate. And the bed is also pretty small. I think it's just over.
It's just over 4 feet.
I think it's 52 inches. I think
it's 52.1 inches, which I think is what, 4 feet 3 inches.
So it's just over 4 feet. And if you have the optional tonneau cover package on there, when that's retracted, the floor is still that long, but that package cuts back another 4 or 5 inches into the bed.
It's a couple.
So I mean, you're gonna lose some functionality there. One of their press photos actually. They have an option. It's like a little cover for the back of the tailgate where you can load your bike in the back and then the bike hangs over the tailgate. And as
Emmett Smith, that's the photo I wanted to talk about.
Okay, go ahead. Let's bring it up right now, because I thought that was just one of the weirdest press photos I've ever seen.
Here, talk about it just a second while I'm pulling it up so that our YouTube viewers can see it.
I mean, realistically, in this day and age, people want to buy, you know, a one size fits all vehicle. So you can't really go old school with the single cab pickup truck with the longer bed. So if you're doing something that's fairly small in size, I mean, the bed is obviously going to take up, you know, take the biggest hit there. Yeah, we're looking at it now on YouTube. It's the back of the Santa Cruz with a mountain bike in the bed. And yeah, it has
in the bed.
Okay. It's partially in the bed. It's like 85, 80, 70. It's mostly in the bed. And it has that protector that lays over, that goes over the tailgate. But it looks like your neighbor just threw their bike in the back of the truck because it was laying in the driveway and they weren't bothered to put it in the garage. And it's just, I know they're trying to show, hey, look at the functionality of our truck, but this just comes across as, you know what, maybe we should have made the bed a little bit bigger.
Yeah. And so that's the thing, that this is the image that I wanted to talk about, because this is the image that I saw and I'm like, oh, a Santa Cruz might not be for me. So just so everyone knows, my wife and I, we have a 2012 Subaru Outback. It's not a mountain bike. It's a Cannondale. It's, you know, it's hardtail suspension, stuff like that. I have put it in the back of our Subaru with the seats down without any issue. It's fully enclosed. It's not hanging out like this is. Like, to me, and granted, that's not something I do all the time. It was honestly something I could transport it from one place to another twice, but I could do it. And then I look at this and I'm like, wait, I can't even put a bike in? And then also, Hyundai, shame on you. You didn't tie the bike down. So if someone were driving like this, the handlebars are going to be moving all around, like the bike's going to be shaking. Tie your stuff down properly, Hyundai, even in your press images.
I thought that was just I just don't think that's a flattering way to advertise your sport adventure vehicle when you can't even fit your mountain bike in the back. And I'm with you, Bruce. I was disappointed. I mean, I guess I understand, but I was still disappointed to find, I mean, how hard would it have been to make a pass through from the bed that reaches inside the cabin?
And that's something we heard a lot. Our boss, John Neff, said that. Also, yep. Our coworker, Brandon Turkus, said that, you know, the Chevy Avalanche back in the day, it had a pass through, you know, like that's not novel technology. You could make something. So if you had a longer item, you know, maybe not for a bike like this, but say you're hauling, you know, lumber or something that skis, something that's longer, you could fit it in there by putting it through the pass through. Right. And
yeah. Now, in Hyundai's defense, I mean, they do have an optional bed extender where you fold down the gate. And right.
We haven't seen that, but they say that's going to be.
Yeah, it'll bring it out. And I mean, obviously, it does have a tailgate. You can fold things down. You can stick things out the back. It's never ideal.
Certainly.
But it seems to me for something like this, a pass through, at least for the interior, where if you needed to go to your local hardware store and pick up just hypothetically some lumber because you're building a homemade racing cockpit, but I've never done in my life.
Of course not.
You would rather take your pickup truck instead of your, again, hypothetically 2004 Mazda 6 5-door hatchback, which could swallow actually those big 8-foot long sections of 2x4. You couldn't do that with the Santa Cruz, unfortunately. But I feel like we're being a little too harsh here. I think Hyundai has come out with a very interesting vehicle. I hope that it's competitive in the smaller pickup truck market, because we're certainly at a point where that market is expanding. And I think there are many buyers out there who would like a truck. I'm not going to call it a sport adventure vehicle. I'm going to call it a truck.
It's a truck.
Because
let's call it what it is.
I think there are a lot of buyers that want something like this. They're not interested in a large full-size pickup truck, whether it's the size, whether it's the fuel economy. That's just not something they're interested in. So it's nice to see some smaller options coming back that aren't a Toyota or a Nissan. Not that there's anything wrong with those vehicles, but it's nice to see something new and refreshing. And of course, we have the Ford Maverick that's coming out that'll be a direct competitor with this.
Yeah.
I want to take a moment here and show something that we just posted today on Motor One, because we were talking about the Santa Cruz and, you know, we were theorizing, what about making, you know, kind of the classic version of the small truck? And once upon a time, it wasn't a 5-seater.
No, look at an El Camino.
Yeah, it was
Ranchero,
a 2 or 3-seater with a longer bed, right? Mm-hmm. So we had these renderings commissioned, and I mean, I don't know. I mean, what do you guys think about this? I mean, we've basically just lopped off the back seats. Mm-hmm. In theory, this bed. I mean, we didn't do any specific measurements, but with the back seat out and still some storage capacity back there, we're looking at a bed that's probably going to be 6.5 foot, which is industry standard really for a full size truck. Drop the tailgate with a bed extender. You're hauling 4x8 sheets of plywood in there. Yeah. You're losing back seat capability, but I mean, maybe this is a point of discussion. I think there's a niche for a vehicle like this. Nobody's really making one. What do you two think?
Totally agree. This something with a big bed, totally usable. Personally, I would still go for the 4-door short bed for my own needs. I don't really haul around a lot of big stuff, mostly dogs that need to go into the back seat. Personally, I think, you know, Smith, I think you mentioned Hyundai's really making a lot of neat stuff that's hitting in the feels. I'm driving the new Elantra this week is one of the cars, and it's like freaking awesome. It's great. One of the best cars I've tested all year, objectively, to hit its marks. And I think that this is going to drive really well. And I think if they made a 2-door long bed, all-wheel drive, that might be one of the neatest cars to develop like a cult following or sort of a loyal basis off of that.
I would agree. And I'm with you there too. And in fact, I've been thinking about a new vehicle for a while now, and I stumbled upon a lease deal for, I think the Kia K5, which I mean, it's, you know, it's pretty much the same thing as the Hyundai, like $175 a month. And I'm like,
oh, wow, that's awesome.
That's, that's a really good looking vehicle if you want to do a new lease. So yeah,
they drive great, look great. You know, Kia, Hyundai stuff, great driver assistance is standard in a lot of their cars too. Gotta say they're really killing it in almost everything I've driven recently.
And if that could translate over to the Santa Cruz here,
it sounds like it will. And I think the Santa Cruz is going to be super popular. We're going to see these things out in California with surfboards hanging out half the back. I'm sure someone will make one so it can kind of go up towards the roof. Lots of opportunities here for accessories, for styling upgrades. And you know what? For most people who just drive F-150s totally unloaded, this is a great solution.
That's a good point. The photo I just put up here for our non-YouTube watchers, it will have a digital instrument cluster available. Unfortunately, Hyundai did not give us a very good, just like full dashboard image. So we kind of have to look at a bunch of images and kind of imagine how they all look stitched together. But you will be able to get a digital instrument cluster. You'll be able to get kind of I still think it looks good. Hyundai's latest infotainment system that has the stereo display that makes it look like a Nixie clock. I'll be throwing that up here in just a second, but it basically looks like vacuum tubes with little numbers in them. And it's stupid. Like it's not adding any extra functionality, but it looks pretty cool. So that's why I'm on board with it. For anyone who wants to see it, it's right there now. So yeah, I don't want anyone to think that I'm down on the Santa Cruz. I don't know if it's necessarily the right vehicle for me, but I love that the compact truck segment is coming back after being gone for, 30 years? When did the El Camino die? Late 80s?
Well, I guess if you want to technically talk compact truck, we could, go back to like 2012 when I think the last fleet versions of the small Ford Ranger.
Sure. Okay. Good point.
But if we're talking about like car based stuff, I mean, yeah, we're going back to the '80s for the El Camino.
Well, Subaru Baja, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. There was the Baja. How did I forget about the Baja?
Baja's so rad. That's why I like this. It's like the Baja reincarnated with great tech. That turbo engine sounds pretty potent. And I'm sure it'll have a great warranty like every other Hyundai too. Seriously, it's going to be a kick-ass truck, I think.
Yeah, I mean, all of them standard all-wheel drive, the dual clutch transmission with paddle shifts. So
yep, that's on the turbo. The naturally aspirated one just gets a standard 8-speed.
It does. Okay.
Yeah, and then the turbo.
But no CVT in the base one. It's a torque converter auto. Nice.
8-speed automatic.
That's awesome.
Yep.
There could be a lot of potential there.
Hyundai doesn't really do CVTs. Hyundai and Kia, they don't really.
Well, this Elantra I have has one, and it's not amazing, but it's also not terrible, but I would much prefer a direct connection somewhere.
Sure.
So gentlemen, are we a little early to say Hyundai Santa Cruz N?
Ooh, I mean, that could be spicy.
Did you hear it here first? Maybe. Come on, Hyundai.
Pretty easy. It's an existing platform. So, you know, but
would the N be sporty in terms of performance like they're known, or would it be the N as in like off-roady?
An off-road?
I think you would have to go off-road.
So it'd be like a TRD Pro N thing.
Everybody and their brother's doing the special off-road truck. Who's doing an on-road performance truck right now?
You got a good point.
Nobody.
Yeah, but I think the special off-road trucks are selling really well. Frontier will have a Pro 4X, even a two-wheel drive Pro X trim. That's probably the closest in size. Tacoma has TRD Sport and TRD Off-Road. That's all I see around here in Colorado. I think it would be leaving money on the table if they didn't do an off-road version.
Yeah, maybe, but I mean, the classic sales tactic, I mean, go where your competition isn't. Nobody's doing an on-road truck, and I don't know if Hyundai buyers would be interested in that hardcore off-road.
Oh, that's a good point.
Version too. So Hyundai, build them both, man. Yeah. Come on. You're killing it on everything else right now. Build them both.
So again, let's talk about something that's going to be affordable that's coming up here. Let's talk about the new Honda Civic. Ooh. So we know the full debut is coming on April 28th, but they did debut the exterior. So we can at least kind of comment on that. I suspect this will be kind of a shorter conversation, but, you know, we can all share our feels.
And while you're bringing that up, Bruce, let me take a moment here to ask automakers, why are you splitting up your debuts now? This is ridiculous. If you're going to debut the car, just debut the damn car. Don't debut the exterior. Oh, we'll tell you about the interior later.
Next week. Yeah.
I know the premise here. I know you want to continue the momentum. You're not continuing momentum. You're just frustrating the people that want to talk about your car, namely us. You're frustrating your customers who want to know about the car. So if you're listening, wherever you're at, whether it's in Detroit or Japan, Australia, Europe, if you're listening and you're with an automaker, no more broken up debuts here. If you're going to debut the vehicle, debut the vehicle. And in this case, we're looking at the Honda Civic right now.
Yep.
And I think it's an improvement over the last one. What do you guys think?
Really? I think it's boring. It's dull as dishwater. Sorry.
It's not
no pizzazz. It's got no feel. It's just like, it's just generic car.
It looks a little more mature than the previous one. The previous one just, it looked like the designer wasn't exactly sure. So they just took my advice and did them both.
With this one. This looks like a maxed out one because you can see the LEDs and the headlights. This is really going to look bad with just halogen headlights or whatever the base lighting instrument will be. It kind of looks like someone got punched in the nose and then it kind of blew up a little bit. And it's a little bit swollen, I think, on the front end. But other than that, does the Civic need to be exciting to look at? I mean, this is an everyday kind of car. It needs to be unoffensive and not so much exciting because it needs to appeal to a wide audience.
I mean, to me, it looks a little bit more like the Accord. And I don't have a problem with the Accord either. I actually was very, very close to getting the current generation Honda Civic last year. The year before. I was all over these things inside and out. And I didn't think the exterior styling was bad, but it just wasn't hitting me in the right areas. It felt too busy. It felt like it was trying to be a little too shouty. Kyle, I have to agree with you. The Civic doesn't necessarily have to be exciting. As long as it's handsome, as long as it's not really offensive, these cars are going to sell because they have such a great reputation for efficiency, for reliability, for fun. I actually would have got the Civic Si 2 years ago if my local Honda dealer had bothered to get one, because there were some fantastic lease deals going. And I called them, and I'm out here in Rapid City, South Dakota. So everybody stocks trucks and SUVs. And I said, you know, hey, I heard there's this lease deal going on for the Civic Si. And the salesman said, yeah. And I said, I'll come down right now. I'll come down right now and we'll do up the deal. He says, well, we don't have one in stock. That's like, okay, well, you know, where can you get one? Well, I don't know exactly where I can get one, but I can put you in a regular Civic. I was like, no bait and switch. This is the car that I want. And if you get one, I'll come down right now and buy it. And yeah, they just blew me off. They wanted to sell Ridgelines and Pilots. So I'm a little bitter about that.
A little bit.
But
yeah, so you would have had the car? HDMI exhaust port. Do we know if this one will have the HDMI exhaust port?
I love that, the HDMI.
Isn't that the best thing about the Civic Si? It literally looks like you can just boop. I don't know if I have a cord around.
It's an EV. This is how I charge it.
Right, exactly. But no, look, I think the new one's going to be a big seller. We know there's a huge amount of interest. I have a friend who is really into cars, very much an enthusiast of Japanese vehicles, loves like every new Acura debut is like, he like doesn't go to work, it's popcorn out. This is a big thing, right? And he's all over this. He personally feels that this is a serious improvement. Personally, I don't have that much affinity for Civics in general. Now, if we start talking Type R and some spicy stuff, I get excited. But I think, look, the chassis have always been amazing, naturally. The sporty versions have always been impressive. I think even the current Civic Type R has one of the best shifter feels of any vehicle in history. And if anything, it should just be a pretty good platform for them to make some spicy versions later on in its life cycle.
Yeah, that's a good point. I'm really excited to see how it evolves later on with some of the more interesting versions. And hey, you know what? When it comes out, maybe I'll give it another look if I haven't stepped into a Hyundai or Kia by then.
So we're running just a little bit tight on time for this segment. So Chris, are you looking at our outline right now? I want you to pick the last of the big debuts of this week.
I would like, because I know, I mean, before we do that, I mean, the Ferrari 812, I kind of mentioned this BMW M3, M4 competition, Lexus ES, Buick Envision. I mean, so many things came about, all kinds of weird stuff from the Shanghai Auto Show.
We'll be hitting that in a second. That'll be segment two.
So many things. But just today, we had the Cadillac Lyriq.
In production, guys.
There's still a lot of information we don't know about it, because it's just kind of an exterior look. But I think that's a big one worth talking about. Kyle, have you seen the Lyriq here yet?
Yeah, I have been following it for a while. Personally, it's I think the price point is a big one. $60,000 is a really good value for a Cadillac with this much tech. It doesn't look great to me. I'm sorry.
Really?
Yeah, I don't like it. But I understand a lot of people who do. I get it. It has, I don't want to say zero appeal, but close to zero appeal. And I don't know why I don't like it. Because on paper, I should. If you were to write down all of this car's attributes on a sheet of paper, I'd say, oh, that's got to be great. But I'm not loving that.
Now, I think it comes down to the styling being a bit polarizing, because I know in the Motor One chat this morning, there were some pretty stark divisions as to whether it looked good or it looked terrible. And I fall in the category of good. I love what, I don't know if love is the right word actually. When you look at what they did with that rear pillar, the way it's designed, the way the lights come up. I grew up with a 1960 Cadillac Series 62 convertible. And I loved that car. It was my grandmother's car that my father bought and then he restored. So they made a picture that they turned a picture of me sitting in the car at age 15 into this ginormous poster that sits in my closet, because I mean, I'm a narcissist, but I'm not that narcissistic. I don't need a big poster of me sitting in this caddy. But the taillights on the Lyriq, they just kind of remind me a little bit of those late 50s, early 60s kind of fin designs. So, I mean, maybe that's part of the appeal for me. I like that it has something of a fastback look to it. And it also has a unique look to it. And when you're talking about the crossover segment, whether it's electric or otherwise, I mean, I hate to say that anything different is good, because you could create another Aztec with that thinking. But in this instance, I mean, this car is going to stand out.
And the big thing here is are the tech specs going to hold up? And these are a lot of what we don't know. Right. You know, how's the range going to be? I sort of tend to think GM's taking the approach of throw as many batteries as you can in there to give it the range. But they're not, that's sort of like dumb range. Smart range is let's make the car as efficient as possible, therefore, which also makes it quicker, and save the cost and extra weight and capacity of all the battery packs. So GM's like Hummer plan is like stuff as many batteries as you can in there. Mm-hmm. We don't really know truly the specs on this car. And I think that's going to be, for me at least, the final determination, because for EVs, there's so much more you can get wrong very easily for automakers. And we've seen some big cases of it from big legacy automakers. Maybe legacy is not the right term, existing automakers. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I don't know if GM's got it. I haven't driven an EV from them yet that's like, yes, this is great.
Well, I think they have it styling wise. I mean, right now they're talking about an estimated range of 300 miles. So, I mean, it's not standout, but I mean, it's not terrible. But like you said, I mean, we're still very early in the process here. They're talking about recharging 76 miles of range in 10 minutes. I like what you clarified, Kyle, about the differences in charging, of being able to hit that peak power and then how long you can hold that peak power, how deep into the cycle. I think that's something that a lot of people don't really understand when it comes to EV charging. So we need to know more about this, but I mean, inside and outside, from what I've seen so far, I like it. I hope that we see more like this from Cadillac in the future. And I really like that it has an actual name. I've never been a fan of the alphanumerics. I always thought the U.S. automakers that were moving into the alphanumerics, okay, well, they're just trying to copy the Germans. And you don't need to do that. I know a lot of people roll their eyes when I say, give me a Cadillac Eldorado, give me a Cadillac DeVille. There's such history and legacy with those names. Some of it is poor, a lot of it isn't. And I think you evoke a lot of emotion when you bring back names like that. So I would love to see like a Lyriq Brit, you know, that could be a thing.
Smith, you should talk about why it's called Lyriq. Do you know it's basically the Cadillac Lyriq because Cadillac as a brand, the name, has appeared in more songs in history than any other vehicle manufacturer.
Is that truth?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Cool. That's why it's called the Lyriq. Look, super cool. I think they're putting a lot of weight behind this thing. Will be neat. It's got that kind of curved display that we've seen in like the new Escalade, but the Escalade's got that secondary split display in front. So it looks cleaner to me than the new Escalade. It'll be interesting to see how much tech they harvest out of that vehicle. I'm sure it'll have Super Cruise. I'm sure it'll have, maybe that cool night vision like the Escalade has. I mean, that I just recently spent some time with the Escalade. That thing was awesome. It had so much cool stuff. I hope half of it makes it into the Lyriq. But maybe I'm really curious from you guys, and I know we're a little bit short on time, but which of these electric CUVs are you most interested? You have Lyriq, XC40 Recharge, Polestar 2, Kona, Niro, Model Y, Mach-E, ID4. It goes on and on, of course. So which one for Smith and Bruce has captured your attention and your emotion? Because for me personally, it's the Volkswagen ID4.
Really?
I love it. I love everything about it. I think the specs are perfect. Drives great. I put like, I don't know, 3,000-4,000 miles on them now. They're awesome.
Granted, I haven't driven one, but to me, it's
nice.
Boring.
Yeah, that's the point. It's so unobtrusive. It's got massaging seats. It's priced well. It gets 3 years of free charging. Charges really nice deep into the battery pack. And it's got great driver assistance. And it's just so comfortable and quiet. And it's got play and pause buttons. And it makes me happy.
Okay. So crossover seat or crossovers.
Electric.
Bruce, why don't you go?
Dude.
All right.
What if my answer is none of them yet? Like,
no, that's very fair. What is your okay? So Bruce, you're none. Smith, what do you think?
I mean, it's really a toss up. I think for me right now, I mean the Lyriq is obviously fresh in my mind, and I'm really interested in seeing how that develops and how that shakes out. And Mach-E is also there too, and I think a lot of listeners might be surprised by that. Because I mean, I'm a Mustang guy. I've got a Mustang in the garage, and I've preached quite often about how I don't think this should be called a Mustang, but that doesn't take away from the fact that I think it looks cool. It's supremely quick in GT form, and even not in GT form, it's still going to be entertaining. And I think it's an exciting direction for Ford to take. I just wish that they had the guts to let it stand on its own and not tie it with the Mustang name. To me, it sounds like they're not really sure if people will accept it. So we'll wrap it up in a Mustang blanket. I don't think Ford needed to do that. I think the Mach-E looks like a good vehicle all around. So, I mean, yeah, I guess it's a toss up between those two.
Yeah. If you held a gun to my head, Mach-E would be the one that I picked.
But pretend I'm holding a gun to your head. Which one were you going to choose?
It's going to be Mach-E. Like,
really? Interesting. It's
the one that interests me the most, I guess. Like the other ones, I don't know.
They're all a little boring.
Yeah.
That's for sure. I mean,
Polestar 2 does nothing for him. Like, yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. Polestar 2 I thought was good, but I didn't like the fastback thing. Mustang Mach-E I've driven, probably 5,000-7,000 miles now across the country, and spent a lot of time with that vehicle, and it's certainly interesting. ID4 I think is good. Model Y of course is just great on paper, not so great on pavement is my impression of it. I'll cool. Interested to hear your thoughts, of course.
I'm interested to hear your thoughts since you've spent that kind of time in the Mach-E. Mm-hmm. Have you encountered any of the Mustang people?
Oh yeah,
that have talked to you about it? Because I mean, Like I said, I love the car, but I apologize for my Mustang fans that are listening. it can be hard to be a Mustang person because there are so many people that they don't see anything but like their own Mustang and everything else is trash. And it's just like, you know, like it or not, this has the Mustang badge on it. It's called Mustang. It's fast. It's fun. You know, give it a chance. And
well, yeah, you're absolutely right. Look, the naming thing I got over pretty quick because from my side, I'm just here to evaluate the car as a car. I'm not comparing it to other Mustangs, although that might be kind of interesting one day. I don't think it would hold up that well. The Mach-E doesn't have a great thermal longevity. So when you drive it really hard, it overheats pretty quickly. The GT, though, will have a really much more beefed up cooling system, so I'm told. I've done a couple videos on Mach-E now, sort of driving it hard, driving it easy, all this stuff. And I've shown how the vehicle responds in different environments. But the Mustang people, I was charging at a Walmart in Utah recently, and a woman walked up to the window, and I actually was doing a live stream on YouTube. So it's on the Out of Spec Motoring YouTube channel.
Oh, wow. Okay, I got to watch
this. She walks up, and she says, "I hate your car. It's not a Mustang." I'm like, that's really funny. I really appreciate you. And but generally, I will say the general stuff is like thumbs up. Like people are surprisingly interested in it. We actually bought one. It's a grabber blue one. My friend Dave bought one for us to make videos with. And so, you know, it's bright blue, catches a lot of attention. But generally, overwhelmingly positive. But you do see people kind of like laughing in some cars next to you. They're like, "Yeah, this is a bunch of garbage next to me." And you know what? It doesn't drive like a Mustang. I originally thought it did, but after spending a lot of time with it, it's not sporty enough. The GT will solve all this, of course.
Well, I mean, there are so many Mustangs that don't drive like a Mustang. If you get a 1980 Mustang,
with a four cylinder,
yeah, you know what, that doesn't drive like a Mustang either. And Kyle, to if this makes you feel any better, I had an 03 SVT Cobra, and I loved the car. It was the 10th anniversary. I was trying to join an SVT Cobra group because that 03 04 is you know, it's only a couple of years. And I couldn't join the group because all those jerks did was trash on the newer Coyote Mustangs. Oh, look at these. My 10-year-old car is faster than those Mustangs. Oh, what a pile of junk. So,
look, there's a lot of emotion.
Sorry, Mustang people, but hey, you know what? Come on, suck it up. Enjoy life.
The cool news is you can buy your GT350 that revs to, 8,600 RPM or something ridiculous, to the moon. Sounds amazing. Visceral raw experience. You can get the GT500, which is all that power, 700 plus, DCT, great tech. And you can get the electrified one that you can take your family out on the weekends with, or I should say during the week and the school run. So plenty of options. I think I'm okay with the addition and the growth of the Mustang family to be more of, these are our sporty models. The Bronco will be more of our off-roady models. I'm okay with it.
I'm getting there. I'm getting there. But Mach-E certainly isn't bad. We should probably move on. We talked an hour and a half on Mustang last week. I could probably talk another hour and a half today. Can we take a little bit of an intermission break here?
Absolutely. Yeah. Let's address a very nice email that we received this week.
You know, we've been growing the podcast now since January, and our numbers have steadily gone up. Some episodes have been a little bit better than others. So we're trying to feel out what you folks want us to talk about. And again, we are still accepting emails, podcast@motorone.com. We want to hear your automotive stories. We want to see your automotive projects. We want to hear about your automotive passion. We did get an email. It didn't come with a name attached. It was just,
I think I can, it's Josiah, I'm pretty sure, from the internet.
Oh, look at, okay. You're reading like alphanumeric speak. Okay. Well,
I'm also looking at his email address,
now come on. I'm looking on my phone. I don't see the email address. Anyway,
fair enough.
Anyways, embarrassing, Chris, embarrassing. All right. I just want to let you guys know that I'm absolutely loving Rambling About Cars podcast. Thank you very much. That actually means a lot to us. It does. Motor One is very underrated. Should be right up there with Motor Trend and Car and Driver. Fun fact, our traffic numbers have us right up there with Motor Trend, Car and Driver, Jalopnik. So we appreciate the words. I was wondering if you could have a podcast episode debating about the GOAT. Thanks. So there isn't, first of all, tremendous thank you for this email.
We love getting emails and comments.
We love getting emails, even the emails that say you guys are ridiculous and you don't know what we're talking about. 90% of the time we do, 10% of the time maybe we don't.
Sure. We can't know everything.
Or maybe it's the other way around. Never know. But hey, any email, especially the nice ones, thank you very much. We hope to continue doing great podcasts for the foreseeable future.
Certainly.
There's no clarification here on GOAT. We're going to assume that it's
the greatest of all time.
We could be talking about the Ford Bronco and talking about its the
goat modes. Yeah.
All the goat modes, go off road. I forget what it stands for.
Yeah.
Go over any terrain. I think
that's what it
go
is.
Over any terrain.
Type of terrain. Cause it's GOAT, isn't it?
Is it? I think it's just T.
No, I think it's just T. Just
okay.
This is just one T. Could be talking about the Pontiac GTO.
It is just one T. I just looked it up.
Know why I thought it was two.
Oh, you know what? We are both right. It is GOAT mode, but it stands for goes over any type of terrain.
Right.
So that's what I thought. So it should be take one of the T's out in the acronym.
They could just say go over any terrain.
Yeah.
They could say go over any terrain. And
unless it has to do with that Land Rover battle thing.
I'm going to overwrite everything that Ford Motor Company says about this and say it's go over any terrain.
Sure. But
there we go.
That's something we could do in the future, though, is talk. We'd almost have to go by segment, though, because there's not one greatest of all time car because.
No, there is.
Cars do. Oh, there is.
Uh-oh.
What is it?
Uh-oh.
The Nissan Murano Cross Cabriolet. Nope. You don't understand. This is literally the best car on the planet.
Sell me this argument. Go ahead.
Well, it's totally sarcastic. There's a group that I am obsessed with. It's called Nissan Murano Cross Cabriolet Enthusiasts, which is people who see one and it's like, oh, this is God's chariot. This is like, I'm going to play the lottery. I saw one today, totally making fun of it. But now there are owners in the group that think everyone is serious. So I've now convinced
both owners are in the group.
Owners and enthusiasts that like to make fun of it. So I've convinced.
No. I mean, like both, like the two owners.
Oh, I see what you mean. There's a few of them. There's at least 100 of them that own these things in this group. And they think we're totally legit, but I've convinced Nissan to let me take one out of their heritage collection for the ultimate review of the ultimate car.
Oh, really? You should do a drag race with that.
Can you do?
You should do a drag race with that and a Pontiac Aztec.
No,
and
if you GTR. I could
line up a Mustang 2 for you.
That's okay. We're going to drag race it against the GTR. The cross cab's going to go by. I'll hold my Starbucks, just cruising. You'll have some guy in a race suit in the GTR, you know, pounding off the rev limiter. And, you know, it's going to be really kind of funny, but truly an amazing machine of brilliance.
Hit us up when that happens, because that's internet gold right there.
That's the plan. So if you have ideas to the listenership about fun skits we could do for that, we were going to take them all to like a track and have like race teams working on the Murano and like putting slicks on it and some other fun stuff. So it should be kind of interesting.
I am on board.
So moving on to our second segment, which we'll keep kind of short, but the Auto Shanghai show happened this week. And while there's a lot of, you know, very normal cars that show up there, both from mainstream automakers that are available all over the world and Chinese specific automakers, there's also some weird stuff there. Just weird. And so we wanted to take a moment to celebrate the weirdness that was at Auto Shanghai.
It's also probably worth mentioning really quick. That's part of the reason why we had so many debuts here in the last week or so.
Yeah.
That show, actually, that's one of the few auto shows that took place, that's taken place in the last year or so. So it's neat to have sort of an auto show back. We're also at the same time of year where normally we'd be seeing, the New York Auto Show.
Mm-hmm.
So even though the auto show isn't going on, automakers still have plans for their own vehicle debuts. So there's a little bit of kind of inside look at the world of journalism. When we get these auto shows, even though they're not going on, automakers are still kind of coming out with debuts around the same time. But you're right, Bruce, we see some whoppers from China.
So let's start with, this is by far my favorite just because it's so like, it's so blatantly ripping off a classic, but I also kind of like it in a stupid way. Let's look at the Aura Punk Cat, which
what a name!
Yeah, fantastic name, and it is a four-door near copy of the classic Volkswagen Beetle.
Allegedly. That looks nothing like a Volkswagen Beetle. What do you mean?
Exactly.
He says, dripping with sarcasm. I don't see the resemblance.
Not at all. Here, for our YouTube view, we're looking at the side view now, so we can see how much it doesn't look like a Beetle. Nothing about that roof line. We should note, though, that it is four doors. It's not two doors. It's a sedan.
What a machine.
Is the engine in the back? Or is it up front?
No, it's got to be front drive, front engine. Sorry. I think it's, yeah. Cause look how far back the rear seats are. See the headrests? There's no way you're squeezing an engine back there. Yeah, although these Chinese cars are like 1.2 liters.
Yeah. If there's like a little one lunger back there, bop, 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 pop it along.
Let's look at the interior, which is also kind
Now see, I know that's not a Volkswagen Beetle because there is no spot. Oh wait, there is kind of a rose on the dash though, isn't there?
Yeah.
So okay. So it sort of has the flower thing going on.
The interior. I love this.
Yeah, well, the Aura Punk Cat, which is just
one day I'll import one of these things. After 25 years, you'll see me dailying an Aura Punk Cat.
Okay. So next up, Ed Smith, this is one that you wrote about. I apologize. I don't know how to pronounce the automaker's name. It is either Roa or Rova. And this is the Jing, which apparently in Chinese means whale. And you'll understand why as soon as you see it. It has the face of a whale. There's just no other way to put it.
It does translate. I mean, we looked up Google Translate, and actually the glyph, for those not on YouTube, we're looking at a straight up head on shot. And yes, I mean, it was specifically designed to look like the underside of a whale with those kind of vertical strakes stretching all the way across the front end. The traditional Chinese character there on the plate is the character for Jing, which is whale. So, I mean, it's not an accident, and it's not a nickname.
It's
on purpose. This isn't a production version. This is a near production. The production version is supposed to go out later this year, but from what we were able to gather, it's not going to change very much from this. It's going to have internal combustion power and a plug-in hybrid. There is another fully electric version of this vehicle. Similar, not an exact copy of this, but similar based on this that will be offered at a later date. But yeah, and you know it's white on purpose. I mean, you've got to have the white whale. I mean, when I first saw it, I was like, wow. But then I was like, well, I mean,
other than the grill,
it's kind of goofy. The grill is kind of goofy.
The grill is what does it.
But I mean, it grew on me a little bit. It's not enough to, not enough to make me trade my Nissan Murano Cabriolet. But
nothing comes close to that.
nothing comes close. just one of the interesting things from China. What else we got?
This one is also a concept. This is the Hongqi L concept. So this is a concept for a luxury sedan.
It's just called the L.
The L concept, yes.
Well, Hongqi means red flag, I believe, which is like the pinnacle. It's like the Rolls Royce of China.
Well, you can see
and that here, looks very Rolls Royce-y of China.
It does. It just has this bizarre light signature. And then when you look at the back, it has this weird embroidered effect that I'm not sure. I don't know how you see out of the back of that, but I guess it's a concept, so you don't have to.
You're not worried about anyone behind you when you're driving a Hongqi. This thing is bad to the bone. I love this.
It's something. I like it.
It is.
You know, you'll notice there's no passenger or there's no front passenger seat. And that's because the person in the back can just fully recline. It's, you know.
Imagine how awkward it must be to sit in that chair and like as you're just being driven around.
Yeah, it But yeah, so this is just another example of, and this isn't so much weird. It's just so, it's almost like Baroque. Like it's so like overly styled, the stuff that we don't really see here that often.
That face, it just, can you scroll back to the front? Boy, doesn't that look like somebody who is getting a glimpse of something very exciting that they don't think they should be seeing, but it's like, wow, look at that.
But the
back is a totally different personality.
The rear looks like 1994, 1995 Mustang with those goofy vertical or horizontal taillights instead of the verticals.
Mm-hmm. Well, like a little bit. I see Razor Blade in the way they're styled, but yeah.
Why do you need four of them on each side? Well, I guess why not? You're buying.
Yeah, I think the answer is why not.
Yeah, you would want more.
Well, the fourth is the fourth one on each side. That's an optional extra.
Optional extra. Okay, yeah. That's another 800. I had not seen this concept until now, and I'm in love with it. Seriously, I actually really think it's cool.
And then last one we have here, and this is another Hong Chi, and this is actually going into production. They're saying this is the S9, which is their supercar that is apparently on the way. Here, actually, let me get a better image of that up.
I mean, that's cool.
Yeah, it looks, it's just interesting. We haven't really seen that many Chinese supercars. This one is supposed to have 1,400 horsepower. And they're saying it's actually going into production. So
is it electric?
Give me just a second.
I mean, it looks cool.
According to our story on it, it's a plug-in hybrid with a V8 engine making 1,400 horsepower.
And I mean, it's cool, but Kyle, I think maybe you were about to go down this road. It's another supercar. It kind of,
they all look the same.
I'm starting to get supercar, or maybe in this case, hypercar fatigue. You know what? Yeah. You know, rounded fenders, short front, beefy back, big intakes on the side. That one looks like it had a center mount, just a single windshield wiper, because race cars have one windshield wiper. I took the passenger windshield wiper off my Mustang and it made it so much faster. And yeah, I mean, it's cool, but
I keep grabbing the same image. Hold on one second.
I want to get excited about it, but
I mean, yeah. I don't suspect this is something that's going to be available in the United States, you know, just by
it looks a little bit better from that view.
We're looking at the rear three quarters now.
At least it has some interesting character. It has a little bit of a long tail feel to it.
It does. Yeah.
Can we talk about, no, let's not talk about those wheels. I would rather not talk about those.
Yeah. But I guess like you could go for this, or you could go for the Neo race car thing. Like there's others, I guess the Neo one's fully electric, but I don't know. The thing that is hard to wrap my head around for these supercars is, look, I know there's a ton of people that have way too much money that could certainly afford this and that and that. But at the end of the day, these things don't really impact our everyday lives. So what I would love to see is Hong Chi make sort of like the, I forget exactly the model name, what their SUV is, maybe the HS9, I think. Love to see them make like a real sporty, something crazy out of an SUV, because we know the Chinese market loves SUVs and they love being better than everyone. So how cool would it be if they put this drivetrain in their HS9 SUV? That would just be absolutely bonkers. And I think they would sell 10 times as many as these.
Probably true. But also, you know, there is something about a halo car for a brand that kind of gets them recognition. And if, as they're saying, this actually goes into production, they can say, hey, look, we've got a 1400 horsepower supercar. So, you know. I agree. You're certainly right that the mass stuff matters, but you know, for any brand likes to have a halo, I think.
Sure. Well, not a bad way to start. 1400 horsepower. We're sort of numb to power numbers these days, but that's a ton.
You're not wrong when you say we're numb, because I hear 1400 horsepower. Yeah, that's a lot. And then that's where it ends. And it's like, right. It's like, no, that's way beyond a lot. Oh,
so wrapping up here, we each wanted to pick our favorite debut that we've kind of covered. So, Kyle, you're our guest. Why don't you go first? Of what you've seen, what's your favorite?
Yeah, well, I think the most relevant in our marketplace, the one that could have the most effect on an entire industry, for example, or segment of vehicles, I should say, would be EQS. I think it does. The battle between electric vehicles is no longer on efficiency, technology, range. It's about all of those things, but then the plus. How comfortable is it? How much features are there going to be in there? What's the NVH like? What are the driving dynamics like? And I think it opens up the world of EVs to a new conversation, not focused on paper specs and actually focused on usable daily features. And I'm pretty excited about that.
Very cool. Smith, how about you?
Oh gosh. I'm kind of torn between Santa Cruz and Lyriq. Santa Cruz has, I mean, it has the right now kind of hits me in an area that's not really interested in, but this makes me interested. This makes me interested in looking at trucks again. I love its design. I love the idea of an N model, a nice on-road performance vehicle. But I just like it as an alternative to an SUV or even a modest hatchback, something that stands out different. The Lyriq is, I like the Lyriq because it's not right now, it's looking towards the future, but it's giving us that taste of what it's going to look like right now. And I hope it can mark sort of a new era for Cadillac, because Cadillac's had it kind of rough the last few years. Definitely if they can get themselves refocused and organized and in a good direction, and they can back that up with everything that they're saying the Ultium platform is going to be capable of, then we could have some really great Cadillacs coming in the future.
So I am going to go Santa Cruz as well, even though, you know, I had my complaints about it. I think that recreating or bringing back that small truck segment, the unibody truck segment, I think it's going to be a huge thing. And it's interesting if we look at kind of the time frames, and we don't know anything for sure yet, but it looks like the Santa Cruz is going to be on sale a couple of months before the Maverick is. So it'll be interesting to see if Hyundai can really capitalize on that kind of being first to market thing and, you know, really market the Santa Cruz to be a competitor against Ford, or with Ford being, you know, the kind of the king of the pickups, that once the Maverick comes out, that it's just going to steamroll things. Regardless, I like that this segment is coming back. So yeah, I like to see it.
And you know that, I guess now Stellantis, Dodge, Jeep, you know they're going to be watching Santa Cruz and Maverick like a hawk.
Oh, and General Motors. They both are.
Because, I mean, especially Stellantis, I mean, they have such a portfolio of vehicles they could draw from to bring a small Ram back into the state. So, yeah, we're on the cusp of many things.
Yeah.
Many things.
So, Kyle, we just happen to have enough time that you get to do our new guest quiz.
I was hoping. I was trying to draw out our conversation about the Hong Chi and how cool it was and my cross cabriolet diversion.
We got just enough time before signing. So,
just enough time. Every new guest goes through this. There are no wrong answers, but of course, the people of the world will be judging you internally.
Exactly. So,
no pressure. Bruce, I kind of led the last one we did last week. Why don't you lead us off here this one?
So, what is your favorite car of the 1980s?
Lotus Esprit, I guess, or is that 70s?
There were variants
popular in the 80s. Yeah.
Yeah. You could get the turbo and stuff in the 80s. Okay.
Sure.
What is your favorite car of the 1990s?
Good question. No idea. Maybe a Lincoln Blackwood. Or maybe that's early
2000s. That was 2000s, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's 2000s.
Early 2000s.
See, I'm so young. The 90s, I was still a baby, so I don't know. Hard to say, really, 90s. nothing really came out great in the 90s, did it?
What?
You know,
no!
Yeah.
What? No, that's not
true. Okay, we said, there are
totally
no wrong answers.
This is great.
There are wrong answers.
So my perception of 1990s automotive is lots of cheap plastic and lots of like weird, not very well put together vehicles.
C4 Corvette ZR1, 22 BSDI Subaru, Nissan Skyline. I'm not a Supra fan, but I mean you have to acknowledge the Supra.
FDRX7.
It was also the birth of the LSV8 from General Motors that powered everything. McLaren F1, Bugatti EB110.
XJ220 is cool for sure.
CLK VTR.
Love that.
993 yeah, Porsche.
993s probably is where I fall.
Okay.
But nope, your answer was none.
So my answer was I couldn't think of any cool cars that came out in the 90s. You've given me now three to consider, and the 993 is got to be the best.
So what?
Well, what about? Hold on.
No, this is good.
What about the EV1?
Not into it.
Oh, okay.
So
I think people really halo that car, but it really didn't do anything except piss a whole bunch of people off that they're still crying about it.
Well, it was a first step into a field that we're into now. And
sure, but we weren't ready then. And there's a case that we're not even ready for mass EVs right now.
Yeah, but you know, how much further along would we have been if that just hadn't been canned and put down immediately? I think it was a step in the right direction, sure. And I think it was a victim of circumstances by a lot of other things.
Oh, but yeah. Not to say it wasn't impressive or an interesting story, or it really could have been potentially moving the needle in a direction that it unfortunately didn't. But I think like that's just a failure story. They made a car. We learned really nothing from it, and we didn't do anything about it for 10 years, 20 years.
I would say that's more GM's fault than the public's, but okay.
Oh, sure. Okay. Absolutely. Absolutely. 100%.
What car or cars do you own right now?
So we have a Tesla Model 3, a BMW i3, a electric smart car. We review a lot of stuff, which is fun. And we have a Crown Victoria police car.
What year?
I
can't even remember. Haven't driven it in 6 months. It's in North Carolina at our testing facility. We take it out, do big skids, lots of J turns, never check the oil in it, and then put it away hot. And it's
my first
never
car
died.
Was a Crown Vic. It wasn't a police car.
Love
but it was a Crown Vic. Yep.
Yeah. P71. Whole still got sirens and lights. We told them it would never be registered. It isn't registered. It just lives on a private facility. So the police agency in Hickory, North Carolina, I think it was, sold it to us with sirens and lights in there, which is awesome. And she's rocking. That thing's a beast. We've done a lot of challenges with it. Yeah.
Cool.
Sorry, cool. Last question. Heated seats or heated steering wheel? You get one.
Oh, heated seats.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I have them on all the time in everything.
I'm always surprised because you would think, okay, heated seats. Yeah. I mean, that's your whole body versus your hands. I think it's been about 50-50 thus far, hasn't it, Bruce?
Yeah, it has.
People saying heated wheels, really? Heated seats. Yeah.
That's an interesting question to ask.
60-40, but for seats, I think narrowly go by, but steering wheel still gets picked.
Yeah, that's an interesting one.
I'm with you on seats. If your hands are cold, just wear gloves.
Yeah, well, that and also most cars have preconditioning or remote start now.
None of mine.
Well, modern, new, you know,
sure. No, like I understand this, what
you mean. Elantra has a started start button. But yeah, no, that's interesting. I think lots of cool stuff. I guess we should probably wrap up here, but yeah. You guys all saw the Cars and Coffee crash in Colorado with that demon or the Hellcat happened right in front of me. All I want to say is
you were there. Wow.
Yeah.
It crashed. The hit was right in front of us. And my request is if you go to Cars and Coffee, just don't drive like a jerk, please. Enjoy it for the sport of enjoying everyone else's cars.
Bravo. Bravo. You can, you know, if you want to start up the car and give it a few blips while you're parked.
Rev's fine. Yeah. Just don't do a burnout. Look, you can go to the track as much as you want. It's track events every weekend everywhere.
Yep. Just keep it nice. Keep it sane. Keep it steady. Kyle, thanks a lot for being with us. Well, what do you have for social media that you like to promote here? How can people get hold of you?
Nothing super interesting. It's not hard to find us, but just weird stuff. I wouldn't recommend it, but you can go to, YouTube Out of Spec Reviews. We do a daily video car review every day, and all video, all pretty terrible. So if you go watch it, you're warned.
Okay. Well, thank you for joining us. Good afternoon, good evening, or good night. Whenever you happen to be listening to us, we appreciate it. Your email is podcast@motorone.com. We love your questions. Honestly, if you're working on a project car and you're proud of it and you want to share it with us, send us some pics and we'll share them. Motor One is the YouTube. If you want to watch the video version there, and if not, we're on all of the podcast things that you can be on. So follow us, like us. Yeah, we'll appreciate it. But thank you very much. And thank you guys. We'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.